All right, what we've got coming up. So next Monday, we have a couple of things going on. Don't forget to read the HBR case Army crew team before we have class on Monday. And then by midnight that day, your motivation reflection assignment is due. So you'll have to like cast your mind back to when we talked about motivation, but do the reflection assignment on that. All right, so today is all about innovation and change. And as a special treat, we have a guest speaker who teaches at the University of Virginia Darden School of Business. He has been mostly like senior executive at Gillette, Procter & Gamble, Wilkinson Sword, PwC. So a wealth of experience for decades and decades. He's a co-founder of the Consumer Financial Institute, chairman and board member of several entrepreneurial companies, and he wrote the 63 Innovation Nugget that was your optional text for this course. So let me introduce George Barbee. Come on up.
Thank you.
And he's going to lead us through a really cool kind of discussion about innovation today.
I'm going to look around the name tags because I think I recognize most everybody's name with your good observations that I had a chance to read up until about 10 o'clock last night. So if I hadn't seen it by then, I'm not sure I would have gotten it. Let me say at the outset here, I am looking forward to learning. This morning, we have an afternoon with the Blackstone Launchpad and then an evening class. And I am pretty much assured from what I've read in your observations that my learning curve is going to be straight up, and hopefully I can share a little bit of what's come to me over the years. Just a slight modifier. Thank you for that very nice introduction. I was with Gillette as an executive. I was with I was a partner of PricewaterhouseCoopers, and we sold our business to them. I was an entrepreneur along the way, and I had a chance to work with, and this is important, I wasn't an executive at Gillette, PepsiCo, and GE, but what I did find, and I felt like I was an outsourced executive because we did work together at a very high level. So I use the expression, I worked with them on innovation. So in case anybody Googles that and says, well, was Barbee really an executive? There's a fine tune, but important. Always like to start with the news. Do you all read the Wall Street Journal periodically, occasionally? You probably read it online. I'm still trying to read it online. There's something about the crunch of the paper in my hand that makes it a little bit easier. What was in the news this weekend? We're talking innovation, right? And leadership. What was in the news this weekend about space travel?
Elon Musk, you wanted to go at sort of proposed a plan for going to Mars. At least that was his goal.
Yeah. Going to go to Mars. Maybe in your lifetime. Anybody else pick up anything? Who's Elon Musk?
He was a co-founder of PayPal and started for SpaceX now. Is that how he does SpaceX?
SpaceX, private space exploration. Certainly, by most definitions, colonizing Mars would be considered innovative, right? Put them out there with Steve Jobs, Apple, the whole thing. There's a whole another side of innovation. Who either follows golf or plays golf periodically? Anybody see the Ryder Cup this weekend or hear about it? A lot of head nods. Anybody ever heard of Kevin Na? Kevin Na is on the pro circuit. Kevin has won some tournaments, but Kevin, 2 weeks ago, was playing in the FedEx Cup, which is the sort of the culmination of the season, and Kevin on the third day was in last place. What an embarrassment, right? I mean, here is the playoff of the best players, and he is in last place, and he is not playing particularly well. And to just add insult to injury, they play in pairs the last day. Kevin's partner is Jason Day. Anybody know what happened to Jason Day? He had to withdraw because he was injured. So Kevin Na, in last place, is supposed to play by himself. He goes, in last place, I play by myself. He also has a reputation of one of the slowest players in the entire pro leagues. He says, I got it. And he comes up with an innovative idea. Do you know what he does? Kevin sets about, this is real play, some of it even gets televised, to play the fastest round of golf ever in pro history. And he literally, with his caddy, runs from hole to hole. He runs up, he hits the ball, and he shoots one of the best rounds he's ever shot. And he plays in under 18 holes now, the real stuff, in under 2 hours. Under 2 hours. And he gets all kinds of national publicity. His slow play is now history. You know, he's been the fastest player. Anyway, to me, that is another stroke of creativity and innovation. So somewhere between Elon Musk and Steve Jobs and Kevin Na is the rest of us. And that's really, I think, part of the fun here is to think about this. Let me ask a question. What is, in your mind, the difference between innovation and invention? Sean?
An innovation is useful. So an invention, anyone can invent something, but an innovation finds a market, fits a niche, fits a need.
Sean has said that so confidently that I want to see if anybody else adds another dimension or agrees or disagrees with that. Summarizing, innovation is useful.
Yes.
So everything else is not innovation, right? What do you think? What's the difference? That is a piece of it. What is the difference between innovation and invention? Dave?
Well, when I think about an invention, I think about kind of constructing a new product or service, you know, from the very beginning stages. With innovation, it can be as little as thinking about something in a slightly different way, or, you know, a new marketing strategy, or just, you know, it can, I feel like innovation is a much broader term.
That's cool. Product or service and experiences, you know, something, you got it. I don't know that I can say it much better than that. Anybody else have any other aspects? Difference between innovation and invention?
So Steve Jobs is a good example, right?
Mm-hmm.
He's a great innovator, but he wasn't really an inventor. Like, he took products that were already out there and he just made them better, right? Like, he didn't come up with anything first. He just did it better than anybody had before.
Did it better. And yet we think of Apple and, mm-hmm. and our iPhone as a thing. So I think there's something there between what it might be an improved thing. We'll come back into some other aspects of that. But that's a good way to box it in for a second. Why is another question? Because Teresa told me you were going to bowl me over with comments, so I'm ready to be bold. Why is innovation important to leadership? This is a leadership class. Why the hell are we talking about innovation? What? I'm going to give you just a second, son. And Josh, I'm going to give a couple of other people over here a chance to jump in and bury me here with is innovation important to leadership? And
well, I feel like if you want to be a good leader, you have to keep coming up with new ways to keep people interested or get people motivated or excited about what you're doing. So you kind of have to like think of things in a new way constantly.
Good.
In order to get other people excited.
Great.
Cody? I think that markets are always changing, so it's important to be able to respond to that and dampen this probably not succeed.
Great. And respond and what else to markets?
Respond and hold your market share, maybe perhaps make it grow.
Make it grow and even anticipate, you know, what is going to be happening in the future. Older.
For me, innovation associates with competition, maybe. So in this case, a leader should be innovative to in order to be better than other players in this field.
You got to stay ahead of the competition. You got to imagine where they're going. Anticipate that. You don't want to be me too. You want to be constantly leapfrogging. It's amazing. A couple of other people now. Sean, you had something. Did that get covered?
So the leaders shape events according to their vision. So, you know, there's always the next regulation, the next big disaster, the next market crash. But to actually see not just the event itself, but what you can do with the event and to make that happen, that's the innovation key to leadership.
That's good. Good. Other dimensions of this question? Bill?
I'd say innovative thinking requires you to look forward. You can't be innovative if you're always looking back in the past. And leaders, if you're going to be leading a company or a business, you need to be looking forward to where is the business going, where is the competition going, where is the market going, how do I get there? And so I think innovation and leadership tie together very closely in that aspect.
Really good stuff. It's in my mind, it's hard to talk about leadership, and certainly in business, and not think that a first cousin of that, or one of the characteristics of a great leader, is also an innovator. Have you ever personally gotten thinker's cramp when it comes to thinking of ideas? Or have you ever been around an organization that has organization cramp. The organization just can't seem to get itself there. A couple of head nods. Anybody have an example of a situation where they've just gotten stuck? Or they've seen an organization get stuck? One that you've either read about, Dan?
I think, well, this comes to me at my current job. I work in IT consulting, and one of the client that I'm working on my project just seems totally backwards from like a program management point of view, and they've dug themselves so deep in their current process that they're not really willing to listen to anybody offer them any, I guess, advantages of this process or that process, or you might be more stable and this might go more quickly if you do it this way. They're kind of just like, no, we're too deep and we're just stuck and we don't want to do anything different. So,
yeah, and many of us have heard or seen that kind of environment. That's good. It's like, did you ever, were you enough a part of that that you were able to see them either get unstuck or tried something yourself to help that?
I feel like I've seen both at this point. I think myself and my teammates have tried to come up with a good, cleaner, more concise way to transmit information to the teams on their side that we're working with. And we've also seen them try and set up a better schedule for releasing new computer code or something that they wanted us to work on, but they just never stuck with it for very long. Mm-hmm. It seems like they kind of gave up on their, I guess, their process innovations and ended up kind of just ignoring what we offered.
Yep. So. Well, you try to change an organization, and you try, and if you can't, you either move over to another part of the organization, or you bail out, right? If, I mean, after a while, if they're not going to change, there's probably a train coming down their track. And do you want to be there when the accident occurs, or at least help them avoid it? Other, I've certainly had thinkers think a lot. Let me, I'm sorry, I can't see it.
Ryan,
thank you, Ryan.
I mean, one movie that comes to my mind is Blockbuster. Like, when they had this massive, massive, like, market share, they were everywhere, and just how, you know, the changing way that people watched movies, just, they were not innovative in, like, things like Netflix, they're delivering at home, then they went to streaming, and it's like, and now that company's gone.
Yeah, where are the Blockbusters and the, who remembers buying something at Blockbusters? And how many have bought something at Blockbusters in the last 2 years? There it is. What's the word that we might use in business to describe what happened Netflix to Blockbusters? What's the word? That...
They ate their lunch.
They ate their lunches, right?
Disruptive innovation.
Disruptive innovation, yeah. And there's the neat side of disruptive innovation. If you're on the outside and you see somebody else not looking or not paying attention, then you can disrupt them. That's cool. On the inside, there is, if we don't disrupt ourselves and organize to do that, then we are likely to be hit by a train. So the really smart organizations are seeing what's out there, looking at the trends, and saying, if we don't disrupt ourselves, somebody else will. And that can be a neat part of an organization to find yourself in, if you like the new stuff. If, like Dan is saying, if you want a safe zone and maybe go down with it, no change, this is the way we've done it for years, then, you know, that's another part of many organizations. That's probably the biggest part of most organizations, is doing what they currently do, as opposed to looking at the new and different, and eating your own lunch, or avoiding having somebody else eat it for you. Any other comments or thoughts around this?
We had a project, one of our electives, it was project management was the course, and we had an assignment, a group assignment, where we were asked to bring in a new technology to help expedite this particular situation. And we got really excited because one of our team members said, oh, I've got an app for that. I just found it, and I'm training in it, and we know how to do it, and it'll streamline everything. And so we thought we were on task, you know, to win this. We brought our project in, our results, and it didn't occur to us that a lot of organizations, they don't want to use the cloud. They don't want the virtual storage or offsite storage. They are proprietary. Whatever you develop, they want it just for them. And they want to be able to integrate everything they have on site. And we lost because it didn't occur to us that, you know, and this was just an exercise, but it made me think in reality where I have asked organizations, where are you storing your data? Do you guys have your virtual storage, your remote, your cloud? Do you use cloud storage? Or storage cloud applications, and a lot of them just look at me like I'm crazy. They're saying, why would we want to do something like that when we don't even understand the technology?
So what was the big learning? What was the aha in that experience for you?
That proprietary versus, I guess, cost savings or cost effective operations, proprietary wins out. If an organization or a company believes that they have the secret sauce and they don't want anything leaking out.
Anybody else in hearing that story have another takeaway or a different level, a different takeaway? I think what you said is absolutely, that's what I heard you describe, but I also heard it at a different level. What else in Belda's story? What else is there a message in there? Is it Noella?
Yes, it is. It seems like what I heard from that was that innovation is not necessarily taken as easily for certain people or companies as others. So some companies are more reluctant to change, or good change. So mm-hmm. innovation, they don't want to adopt the innovation.
Good.
So stay stuck, I guess.
Good. Any other dimensions? A great example. And we probably all, if we haven't been in, will be in a situation like that. You get the team together, you're ready to go out, you make this great presentation, you know it's absolutely cutting edge and right, and all of a sudden you find yourself losing.
Maybe it's a matter of doing your homework and making sure that you know what the company is looking for as a consultant. And not exceeding what they're comfortable with, you know? Like maybe in a real life situation, you would have done that because you would have had extensive interviews with the company and you would have known, okay, they won't be able to accept this. But, you know, it's easy maybe to get excited about a potential innovation and the cost savings and efficiency that can come from it. But it could be that the company isn't able to do that yet.
Yeah. It's all of these things. I'm looking to see if there's a blackboard. There's not, so I'm going to have you use your imagination here.
I can open up the whiteboard for you.
We've probably seen enough about Barbee anyway.
Yeah.
You don't want to have people vomit here. I'll tell a story and then that you triggered. Thank you. When I was with Price Waterhouse, a lot of them are all the Price Waterhouse Coopers now. We put together a team and they were going to go propose on the Pepsi audit. The audit for PepsiCo. Big global firm, so, you know, put the best, most senior people on it, people that had experience in the consumer packaged goods business, put a team around it. The best people, most experienced, and went in, made a presentation. Everybody looked at themselves after and said, we were great. We just, you know, we got it hands down. And it didn't take 12 hours for the chairman of the board to call up and say, you guys lost. And everybody went, what? Can you imagine what, it was so fundamental. It was called not really observing. What is it that you could imagine that PricewaterhouseCoopers in that presentation missed? PepsiCo. Are you thinking? You're close, David? Give it a shot.
I was thinking if you only have people there that are already familiar with their industry, maybe you're lacking some unique perspectives from people that work in other industries.
That's a very good one, and that may have been a cousin of what we heard back. In this particular case, that was actually very good to imagine. We put our most experienced, often with that comes older, more experienced, and the team that PricewaterhouseCoopers has put together were all in their mid-50s. The executives at PepsiCo were late 30s and 40s. It was like they didn't see their audience. Nobody said anything. It was just there. These people thought completely differently. They thought, well, I'm going to have that old team in there. They got the experience. We could buy that separately. But they wanted people like themselves who were on the edge. And the team that won it was the team that went in there with the 38 to 47-year-olds. Just, again, thinking about knowing your audience, which is one of the things. And then I'm going to open this up, give Teresa initially a crack at this, and then you all, and then we're going to make some time to talk about your observations as you submit them. Okay to write on this?
Yeah.
I'll use a different This came to me, this insight about, I want to say it was an advertising, Ogilvy & Mabry, one of the big advertising agencies, made this observation. They used to have, they were an advertising agency, right? So advertising, the creative people were in the center. They were the star of the show. And advertising agencies at the time, they had media people, they had market research, they had any number of accounting services they could do. They had a variety of services, but they were all ancillary to advertising. The creative guys, men and women, were king. And this insight came from the chairman, who said, you know what, the other thing that's going on is, that's in the US, but the world is changing. So we need to rethink ourselves. And he decided to put a client in the middle. And what happened is, advertising became just one of the things they could do, and the market research and media, and eventually social media became things that you could take to a client. Is that a significant difference? What, why is that? Why is that significant? You were shaking your head. I'm sorry, I don't see your name.
John.
Sorry, John. Sorry. Thank you.
Kind of like looking at your end state where, you know, if advertising's your only means, you're limiting yourself to how can advertising fulfill a need, whereas if it's a client, then you open yourself to other resources that can fulfill the needs of the client. So I think, you know, just changing the target limits yourself or it impedes what other variables are available.
Yeah, good. Anything else? Other dimensions there that you see? Yes, Arsha.
Because the now the focus is the client. So he goes to the media, or he wants the social media, or he wants the marketing. What kind of aspects he is looking for? That's why the center is now the client. So earlier it was only the creative, so you are focusing on the creative things, but the client doesn't want the creative things. He must be doing something different.
Yeah.
So now the focus is the client. So everything goes around the client.
The changing the culture from a selling organization, basically, we're here to sell them some advertising, right? And the organization goes in and they're gonna sell them some advertising versus like, what does this client need? And we better understand what they need. Listen at a high level. Maybe it's some advertising. Maybe television is dropping down and cable's picking up. And what about social media? All these things that are changing. That mindset is a very important way to culturally change the mindset. And we can go into some other stories around that, but I was fortunate enough to be part of PricewaterhouseCoopers when, in fact, it changed its mindset, trying to become a corporate global organization from an audit organization. And when the advertising guy put the A in the middle and said, you know, here's what we were doing wrong and here's where we got to, I went, ding. How do you get audit out of the A, audit out of the middle and put all the services that we can do, but even more importantly, what is it that we can be doing in the future that fills an anticipated need of those clients, whether those clients are GE or PepsiCo or somebody small. So, should we maybe take a deep dive into some of the great results we had last night, then we'll open up to some questions that Teresa and you all might also have. So let's see how we are approximately, I hadn't done the count, are we 24? approximately 24?
Yeah, it's usually, I have a couple of students out, let's see, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 22, 24 exactly.
24. Let's try 6 groups of 4, okay? So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to point to you, and you count 1, 2, 3, 4, and you all will be a group, and then I'll explain what I'm going to have you do in just a second. So
1,
2, 3,
4.
A group.
1, 2,
3,
4.
You all are a group. 1,
2,
3. If you could, I'm sorry, I can't see your name.
Claire.
Yeah. You'll be the fifth in that one. So I'm going to have you become with Charles over here, be part of a group. So you'll be 1.
2. 3.
4. You all will be a group. And
1.
3.
4.
1.
2. 3. 4. 4. Good. There we go. Okay. Everybody in the group, don't forget. It's important. Now, what I'd like you to do is take no more than 10 minutes and meet as a group and talk about the observations that you did and submitted to me. I've had a chance to read them. I've got some favorites, but most importantly, I want to know what you all did. Where did you tell each other where you went, what you observed, what your takeaway was. And if you get a moment to talk about some of the senses, fine. But among the four of you, in 10 minutes, come up with what you think is the most innovative and useful observation in your group. And we're going to have you share that back. So you'll each take in 4. Out of that, select a leader to describe to the rest of the class what you took out as the leader. The time is 11:35.
Okay.
10 minutes. Break. Talk. Okay, wind it up in a minute, if you would, and select the one that you'd like to share with the class, and who's going to share it, please. Thank you for being here.
Yeah. You're welcome.
Okay, who would like to go first? We're going to try to do this, just take a crisp minute or so and describe which one of the observations came out in your group as lead. I'm sure, because I thought there were a lot of them that got it. So this will be an interesting study to see what came out. Cody, you had your hand up?
Yeah, we did talk about this place called Five on Black. It's a restaurant in town.
Right.
And it's innovative. It's like a fast casual restaurant. So it's not fast food and it's not a full-on sit-down diner. It's kind of a mixture of both. And we actually had the guy that owns it came and talked to a couple of us that have another class. And his whole thing is that, like, the customer experience is like 45 seconds long or something, just so they can get a lot of volume in there. One thing they do that's pretty innovative is they cross-train everybody so that they're proficient on all different areas in case someone's gone or someone's in the back or whatever. They don't have to stop the line because so-and-so isn't on the cash register. Nobody else knows how to run it. So,
cross-training. Backing each other up,
kind of
an experience. What was the experience?
The experience is nice. So I did this one. I mean, it's inside. You know, the colors are. You know, it's a pleasant guest experience in there. It feels like a decent restaurant. Like you could go in and sit down and relax. You also can take it to go. They have seating outside. As well, like in downtown is the location they went, where it's like there's, you know, these little tables out front. You can watch people cross by and Higgins. But like inside, it doesn't feel loud, it doesn't feel abrasive, and but they can turn volume quick. The food is super healthy, the flavors are great, the price point is reasonable. It you know, it just everything it's hitting, it's like you're taking like a Chipotle experience and but like making it really lovely, and you're making the food way healthier. You know, and so they're really thoughtful about the people that they hire. It's really charming, charismatic, like energetic people. So it's like you go in and it's just that you're greeted with a lot of joy. The options are pretty, you know, you have one, you choose one thing at each spot. So
what would be the word sixth sense isn't exactly clear to everybody, and it's not exactly clear to me. What would your sixth sense tell you about 5-on-1?
It was just it makes you feel positive inside.
The totality of that place.
That's the sixth sense that I took from it.
Good.
To add to that, when you leave, usually when you go eat a burrito bowl or a rice bowl, you feel really heavy and like full afterwards. But the best part about 5-on-1, I think, is after you eat their food, you don't feel like full. Well, you feel full, but you don't feel like overly
stuffed.
Full, like sick. Right. Like you just feel good.
Bingo. Thank you. Next group.
Sean. So, one of the groups we talked about was Bloom Content. They were started by a local entrepreneur. I actually went to high school with the guy who started it. He spoke to one of our classes. And basically what they do is they disruptively innovated because they found a way to serve lower cost markets for advertising. So if you run a small business and you want an advertisement, but you can't afford the $5,000 or more for an ad agency, but at the same time recording something with your iPhone isn't professional enough, then they hook you up with college students, usually undergrads prior to graduating, who can make the content for you. So the big innovative parts there is that they hit untapped markets and an untapped labor force, and we're able to add value for all of them. In addition to that, they plan to focus on sort of marginal American cities, the mid-sized cities, say the, you know, Boise, Seattle, Missoula. They're in right now they are in Salt Lake and Missoula. So.
Advertising, social media, sort of outsource it to, I won't say low end, but lesser expensive students, right?
Yeah, so they provide, it's a lower price point and certainly commensurate with that, lower quality, but it meets the market need. So it does everything that it needs to do.
Cool. Somebody else had, there were two people that used Bloom Content, and who was the other person that had that? Thank you, Charles, yeah. I thought that was a terrific one, maybe because it plays to the advertising, you know, what business are we in? Serve the needs, right, as opposed to just sell the advertising. And if you'll see me after class as to, I've made a connection in an entrepreneurial sense to something I'm doing next week in Chicago with the Art Institute. It's just kind of wild, but it's neat. But thank you for those. Next group, Dylan?
We did Enlighten Labs. They're a new company in Missoula who's providing a sensory deprivation tank environment.
Can you spell Enlighten for us?
ENLYTEN.
Thank you.
And they're providing sensory deprivation tanks for like 1 hour periods. So you buy 1 hour to go into a sensory deprivation tank to sort of like unwind and reboot. And they talk a lot about sort of like the science behind it and the reasons why it's beneficial for
like
you.
Like physical therapy?
Yeah, physical therapy.
Or massage.
Or like sports therapy type thing. And also, like, they're saying it's really helpful for the brain because you can sort of just not think. And you don't have to worry about anything because you can't hear anything, you can't see anything, can't feel anything.
Is there anything else around like that?
Not in Missoula, anyway. I'm sure there is other places, but...
There's actually another one opening up. They opened up with, like, there's two sensory deprivation places to go now.
What did you call it? Sensory relief?
Sensory deprivation.
Sensory deprivation. I'm not sure I can even spell it, but we all heard it. Okay, good. Yeah, I've not heard of that before. I was reading that last night. I had to read it two or three times because it, I said, well, that's not unlike going out and observing, putting ourselves on listen, turning off everything. We all do this all the time, right? We're great at triple tasking. We're lousy at taking time out and having that affect our creative juices. And I think some of that was evident in the writers. Next group, thank you. Yes, Christopher.
We talked about freestone climbing in Zilla. Freestone climbing.
Freestone climbing.
Yeah.
Okay.
And the reason, is because it's the first bouldering gym in Missoula, and bouldering is like rock climbing, but instead you don't use, but instead of using ropes and a belay device, you just have a wall that's no more than about 15 feet high and a padded floor, and you just get on it and go. And that's the reason that's innovative, is because it eliminates the need for a partner in climbing. You don't have to have the equipment, you don't have to know how to belay, you can just get on there and go, and it really lowers the barriers to entry for new climbers. And that's it's a really nice experience just to get on a wall and start climbing.
You can do it by yourself. That in itself is unique, isn't it, for climbing? We've all been told you don't want to swim or climb without someone else. Good. Anything else in that?
Well, they did a couple other things that were really interesting about bouldering. The bouldering difficulty is based on this thing called the V scale, where V0 is the easiest and it goes up by a number at a time, like V1, V2, et cetera. And that can be kind of confusing for new climbers. So they changed it to a color code system. So no dot at the beginning of the route is the easiest. And then a blue is like a V1 or a 2, and then it goes green and then yellow. So then you can just really easily gauge your climbing ability. You can say, well, I can do a blue and a green. Maybe I can move on to a yellow. And then it also, like with the V scale, it kind of gets more intimidating because you think, well, I can do a V4, but there's no way I can do a V5. But when it's a yellow, you can think, well, that could be a V4 or a V5. And it's like, well, I might as well just try it because I can see what I can do.
Cool.
Yeah.
Great. Thank you. Another, the entry point of climbing, I thought that was really neat. Who's the next group? Dan.
So in our group, I think we decided on Advanced Technology Group. And that's actually the company that I currently work at. And I think the innovation mainly came from a company culture point of view. And the observations that I made, it was on Friday from 4 to 5, and every Friday from 4 to 5 we do the same thing. We call it Club MSC, which is our kind of blow-off hour, where we all get together and we share some beers and we socialize. And it's a nice opportunity for myself and a lot of my coworkers to interact with one another when we otherwise wouldn't really see these people, because they either work on different teams or work on a different floor. And so the thing that strikes me the most as unique in this context is the acknowledgement aspect. You know, we go around and we nominate people for, a performance that goes above and beyond standard job requirements throughout the week. And we go around and nominate people for this award. But the other nice thing is that it's an opportunity for coworkers to bring in friends and family and expose them to the culture. So I think ATG's just done a good job trying to bring friends and family in the face of the business and really emphasize the kind of life and work integration that a lot of startup companies do.
Life and work balance, huh? Mm-hmm.
Most of us are struggling that all of our career, right? And at least they're addressing it. That's cool. You get most of the thoughts there. That's good. Next, who? Next, yeah.
We talked about. I think we've decided on maybe just going with Big Dipper ice cream.
Mm-hmm.
And I think one of the things that they've done really well is they're in a highly visible area. It's high traffic, and what they kind of do is, if you ever go there, there's a ton of employees working, but they only have one or two people running the register. So it's a huge line out front. So if you drive by, everybody's like, oh my gosh, well, that must be really good ice cream. And it is good, but I think they've created demand for themselves by only forcing you to kind of wait for it and see this big line as you drive by every time. So it's kind of, we kind of decided they've kind of been some innovative visit, creating demand for the product, like just making you wait.
As I recall, Big Dipper had a number of points about the census. Did you all talk about that? No. Who had Big Dipper?
Yeah, I
talked
about
that, but not. Okay. All right. Then I'm thinking about one of the other ones. So.
I also wrote about Big Dipper.
Oh, okay.
I touched on a lot of the census, like the smell is very green. Like, I mean, to me, it just smells like sugar and like waffle cones. And I mean, it's just there's a very definitive smell when you like as you get close to like the Big Dipper.
You start drooling.
Yeah. And then there's also very like the smell combined with the other senses, like it's a very vintage kind of, it brings back a lot of memories. I think it's a good memory.
You see the atmosphere that they're, you see the line. Yeah. Okay. Usual. Okay. Anything else? What are the senses? I see. Here, what's going on hearing wise? People in line, talking.
Talking, laughing.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's generally very positive, busy, families, children.
Taste. If it doesn't taste good, what's going to happen to Big Dipper? It'll tank, right?
Yeah, there's an ice cream shop in Bozeman. And their ice cream is nowhere near as good. We were so disappointed because it was kind of like the Big Dipper of Bozeman. It wasn't Big Dipper, but it was this other. And we were like, oh, this ice cream is kind of meh. Big Dipper ice cream is really good. And I love how they do the flavors, and they have like flavors of the day or whatever. So they always have like unique choices.
Yeah, the flavors are very unique.
So it brings a variety.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was, to me, it just hit me as a good example of, you know, the senses don't apply to everything, but this was one of them. You didn't have to work too hard to see them all coming together. But that was pretty clever. Next group, who haven't we heard from?
I think that's everybody.
2, 4, 6, that's it. Okay, so what we're gonna do now to close out to, we have 12:10 or 12:20?
12:20.
12:20.
About 20 minutes.
We're gonna open it up to some questions. I told Teresa she'd get first crack if she wanted, otherwise she could pass you on. Just really around to discuss whatever you'd like around innovation and try it on for size.
How closely related do you think your concept of innovation is to the, I can't remember who first formulated it, but the whole concept of a paradigm shift, just approaching problems differently, whether or not they actually invent a new process?
I'm not sure who exactly you talk with, but when you say sort of problem solution, need fulfillment. I don't think I have any unique thoughts there other than, and it was one of the things that we maybe didn't cover earlier on an aspect of innovation versus creativity. To me, one of the distinguishing characteristics is you're innovating. You can have a visual arts person who's very creative or a sculptor who's very creative, but it may just sit there. An innovator, in my mind, is driven to something that differentiates for value. Making money is not a bad thing. And so to me, one aspect of innovation versus just being creative or being just a good problem solver is driving it all the way to making some dough. It's not a bad thing, you know? So next week I was asked to come to the Art Institute in Chicago, and what they want to do is help their creative, it's one of the leading creative visual arts and theater arts schools in the country, and they want to have their artists feel more entrepreneurial. They want to do something with it. They may change a social view, they may take on something that is a big something. It doesn't always have to be innovative to make money, but to me that would be a fine line. I happen to be a great believer in capitalism. I love to make ethical, good money. And that to me is at the heart of innovation.
Yeah,
So I don't know if I answered your question there, but try me again or someone else.
Sure, yeah. Okay, so when I read your book, one thing that I noticed was that what that kind of pulled out of it is that innovation is not just for entrepreneurs. We talked about a lot of entrepreneurs when you guys were talking about your observations, but it's also important for the folks within companies, right? Like the folks that want to develop great products and services for their clients. So I'd like you to share, if you could, a couple of ideas about how this idea of intrapreneurship resulted in some great outcomes.
Good. See if I can say this great insight correctly. I always have to think about it. Most entrepreneurs are innovative, but not all innovators are entrepreneurs. And I think what that means is that the lifeblood of any organization that you go to work for has got to stay fresh. It's got to stay changing. It's got to be innovative. And the leadership of that organization wants to get the word out that this is maybe one of the most important things that it can have its people do. So you can be very innovative in a medium, small, medium, or even large, or very large Fortune 500 company. And you can be innovative and create a path that helps the senior leadership grow. You don't have to be an entrepreneur to be innovative. And I would say career-wise, something to think about is why not learn it on somebody else's nickel? a chance to be in the right organization, to learn something, to confirm. We all learn, we have failures. It's a great time to learn, producing something that is needed in the small, medium, or large company that exists and that can pay you a salary while you're confirming or denying your own entrepreneurship. So one of my cautionary things, especially if somebody hasn't been working, is start with a job and then become entrepreneurial and confirm or deny the fact that you're willing to take that kind of risk and learn on somebody else's nickel. Other thoughts or questions? Yes, Christopher.
So I thought it was interesting with the innovation exercise that you asked about the sixth sense, because I don't think we think about that enough when it comes to business. And I think sometimes it can get lost when we're just thinking about how to make everything work. So how do we become more aware of that sixth sense and how do we leverage it to our advantage in the process of everything?
How did you for yourself define the sixth sense?
You mean in my own exercise?
In your exercise or now in your own mind?
I don't know. I always come back to that movie with the kid. it was just like the general feeling, the combined sense of all the combined feeling of all the senses coming together that a business creates. So the general feeling that it creates for you, like freestone climbing, you go in there, it's kind of like, because there's only one employee working there at a time, it's kind of like a sense of independence and freedom of climbing within these certain problems on the wall. So that was kind of my sixth sense, but I don't know if freestone is really aware of that, and it would be interesting to ask them about it. But as a business person, what's the best way that you can become aware of that? Is it just using your own products, or is it the thought process that goes behind it?
I've got one of those kind of airy-fairy answers. The answer is it isn't airtight, the definition of it. But you've just given a good example of it. One of the things that is easier to define in a way is what I call the experience economy. There's a book written on it. As a matter of fact, I've co-taught the last 12 years at Darden with Jim Gilmore with the book, The Experience Economy. He had a great influence on my book. And here's the question. Why is it that you will go to one restaurant and pay $30 for a filet, and you'll go to another restaurant, maybe it's on an occasion or something, and you'll pay $50, same cut of meat, and you'll say, that was a great experience, and you paid $20 more for the same cut of meat. You probably don't think of it like that. What you've all maybe had an experience like that where something happened. What is it that happens?
Yeah. Well, it's that feeling, you guys. Like with the restaurant, it might be the other people that are in the restaurant, or the certain level of service you get from the waiter, or if the chef comes out to your table and asks you how your meal was. I would pay more to talk to the chef than I would to talk to a waitress who doesn't necessarily know anything about where the meat came from. So I think it's like everything all involved. And then that feeling you get when you're laying in bed at night and you're like, oh, that was such a great night. You know, like what it's those things that make it a great night.
Mm-hmm. Great. Other thoughts?
Well, I used to work at that restaurant that you would pay $50 for that steak. So it was just like what we did so well. It was the elegance. You walked in, it was these large wraparound booths in the middle of San Francisco, which, you know, every other place you're packing in tables tight, and it's like, you know, this leather everywhere, and the wood and the mahogany, and, you know, just the classic service, the white tablecloths, the details were all there, but you went in, and every time I ate there, I knew how chaotic it really was on the back, but when I had that guest experience, it was phenomenal, and I always was kind of blown away. It's meat and potatoes, but it's like, the whole experience of it. I mean, it was just so soothing. We had live jazz every night. It was just these things that made you felt fancy, you know? And it's that sort of like how much you leave there and you were nauseously full, but you were like really feeling great about yourself.
Other dimensions of what makes an experience like something more you'd pay for. You're buying an experience. You're paying more money. Consciously or unconsciously. Sean?
To a certain extent, there's the social capital, so I'm like being able to not necessarily be obtuse about it, but to brag about it, like say, oh, I ate there, you know, like mm-hmm. that's pretty neat. You know, all your friends are like, oh, all the cool people ate there.
Yes?
I think, you know, more recently we have, we're more socially conscious of, you know, things like being green and sustainable. So regardless of whether you have proof of something being green and sustainable, but if you believe that, you know, a product or service is more of those things, or more the company behind them is more conscious of those things, then you're probably going to be willing to pay more for those services.
Of you. Yeah, it's one thing to look over the parking lot and have great food and be well handled, you know, surrounded by leather chairs. Another would be you've got this fabulous view and some of these other things mm-hmm. come together. One of the neat things about experiences, which kind of gets back, Chris, to your point, is there is this overall gestalt, intuitive sixth sense that this is good value. So I don't know how to say it much better than that, but that's a good test. And think about in your own experiences, those places, you might have traveled to them, you might have eaten there, and if you can think of one as simple as a car wash, there's now the car wash experience. You don't go in and just get your car clean. It's how they treat you while you're waiting for your car. It's what you get to see. It's what your children might do. I mean, the differentiation and the innovation that's available to most products and services in the experience of level area is a pretty exciting category. Maybe time for one more, two more, how are we doing?
Yeah, maybe time for a couple more.
Anybody, yes?
From all of your personal and professional experiences, do you have an example or two of kind of your personal favorite examples of innovation? that you've seen?
Well, I'll tell you, one of them today was Bloom Content. I thought that, and so, I mean, I have a feast of these, so you'll get me started, but I'll start with the one that, the idea of matchmaking, the need in the marketplace, you have all these business people around in Missoula, and most of the business people out there, certainly if they're 35, 40 or older, haven't got a clue as to how to work social media. And my understanding of Bloom Content was a way to reach back into the University of Montana or other audiences to basically help them outsource the idea of putting together advertising the way the audience would understand it. So that, that to me is pretty exciting. We all see Apple. We all see what's going on there. I almost try to get beyond Apple because it is so there. But you still go into an Apple store. Do they have Apple stores here in Missoula?
We have Mac, blah, blah, blah. It's not an Apple store. It's like a fake Apple store.
Yeah, and we have one in where we summer up in Traverse City, Michigan. And it's not the same. And there's just something about what they've done at retail and customer service, the way they handle you, either an appointment ahead of time or what. It's just really put together in a terrific way. And if you're not really specific, you just say, oh, it's great customer service, it just kind of floats by. But it's the specificity sometimes that makes for the true differentiation. I suppose in my own career, one of the things that we were very fortunate about, in the 80s, there was financial planning for very wealthy people. It was thousands of dollars. And the company that I co-founded with a couple of brilliant guys, thank goodness they could carry me, we took the whole process of financial planning out to the masses, out to very large numbers of people, because nobody could trust their stockbroker or insurance person. Nobody trusted the people out there that they didn't want to show them everything, get tax help and all that. So I just continue to marvel at finding the unfilled need, whether it's huge or that, and finding innovative ways to fill it. And a couple of them, we don't have time to go over them all, but one of the ones in the book is satisfaction gaps. Just sitting back and thinking about a category that you are interested in personally. It might be fly fishing, it might be rock climbing, it might be consulting. Think about what are the gaps, what's being filled, and what isn't being filled, and think about how you might satisfy some dimension of that gap. And it takes observation time. That'll take us full circle right to the exercise, but taking the time out to think and reflect and imagine, and do it in some quiet time, and you'll come up with some unique things, almost guaranteed, as I think many of you found in the exercise. Maybe time for,
I think we have time just maybe for one more question.
One more quick one? Yeah. Well, I've got one for you. Is there a way to boil down a set of criteria for any successful new product or service? Can you think of some criteria? Okay.
I think the most important thing is that it's got to be something people want.
Okay. It was a trick question, by the way, and that's a good answer. I do have four. And Cody's going to get it started. I'm going to go out on a limb and say that virtually any successful, sustained new product or service has to meet these four criteria. Okay?
That's a big limb.
I hear, do I hear sawing? Okay. Is there a need? And you said it slightly differently, Cody. How did you say it?
It's got to be something that has value to people, that they want, something
they want. Right, that they want. And a little Steve Jobs add to that is, or some imagined, really well thought out need, because not everybody can even verbalize the need. It's hard for us to imagine 20 years ago that you could have a phone that's also a camera, it's also a mimeograph, that's also the 10 other things it does. So, or cleverly imagined need. Okay, that's one. I think I need to be conscious of time. Is there a need? Can it fill? Can what it is you're doing really fill it in a quality way? Okay. This one may surprise you, third. Can it be communicated? Not everything can be succinctly, clearly communicated. So you gotta think about, does it fill the need? Does it do a quality job? Can it be communicated? And the last, here's George playing his cards again. Can you make money? Because I submit that even a nonprofit, if it doesn't bring in money, it won't sustain itself. So it's gonna make money over the medium and long term. Money in the broadest sense, it's got to be able to bring in the dough. I'll leave you with that. You're all great. Thank you. I really enjoyed the time with you.